Please see the link in the description to download a worksheet for this video. Experiments can be dangerous. If you are a child, never do experiments unless your parent, guardian, or adult educator says it's all right and is there with you the whole time. If you have not already done so, we suggest that you watch the video on plate tectonics before watching this video. As we learned in the video on plate tectonics, the tectonic plates make mountains, move continents, make earthquakes, and define how big oceans are. So a natural question is, what moves the tectonic plates? The goal of this video is to summarize the leading current theories to answer that question. In order to do that, we first need to know a little more about the Earth's interior. An active volcano is like a window into the Earth's interior. We cannot see far into the Earth, but scientists have used other instruments to make observations and have theories for what they think is inside the Earth. We'll introduce that theory by reviewing the names and estimated thickness of the layers, what the layers are made of, movement inside the mantle, and state of the asthenosphere. Before we show more technical models, let's pretend the Earth is the size of this apple. The name for the outermost layer of the Earth is the crust. Just like an apple, the outermost layer is very thin, but this is where we and all living things live. This includes all the mountains, the land below them, and the ocean floors. If we could cut the Earth open, we would find a center part. Just like an apple, we call the center of the Earth the core. The part between the core and the crust is called the mantle. One way to remember this is to think of a fireplace. The very center of the Earth is extremely hot, like a fire. In a fireplace, the shelf above the fire is called the mantle. The crust is about 50 miles thick, and the mantle is about 2,000 miles thick. Since the core is the center, we don't describe its size as thickness, but we instead say it has a radius of about 2,000 miles, which we can think of as being the same as its thickness. Here's one way to remember these approximate sizes. The Earth's crust thickness is about the same distance between the northern part of Los Angeles and the southern part of Los Angeles. But the mantle's thickness is about the distance between Los Angeles and New York. And the core's radius is also about that same distance. So, to get to the center of the Earth would be about the same distance as going from Los Angeles to New York, and then back to Los Angeles. Geologists further divide the mantle and core into several more parts. The mantle is divided into the upper mantle and the lower mantle. And the core is divided into the inner core and the outer core. That means there are five basic layers inside the Earth. Next, we'll introduce what the layers are made of. The inner core is solid and made of iron and nickel. The temperature of the inner core is nearly as hot as the sun's surface, which is much hotter than the melting point of iron and nickel. But the metals are in a solid state rather than in a liquid state. The reason the metals are in a solid rather than a liquid state is because the enormous pressure from the weight of the Earth presses them into a solid state. Like the inner core, the outer core is also made of iron and nickel and is very hot, but since there is less pressure on the outer core, it is liquid, and we can imagine it might look like liquid metals. The liquid in the outer core flows around the inner core and in the process makes a powerful magnet around the whole Earth. When you use a compass, you're detecting that magnetic field 2,000 miles below the Earth's surface. Birds can also detect this magnetic field, and they use it to find their way on long migrations, even when they are over water without landmarks and the light is dim. We call that magnetic field the magnetosphere. That magnetosphere deflects tiny particles from the sun's solar wind to the north and south poles, where they interact with the atmosphere to make colorful lights that we call northern lights or southern lights, depending on their location. The mantle is mostly made of oxygen, silicon, magnesium, and iron. It is solid rock, but can be deformed, so over the course of millions of years, it moves. We group the crust into two types, oceanic crust and continental crust. Oceanic crust is an ocean floor and is typically about 5 miles thick. Continental crust is the land, rocks, and mountains above sea level, plus the rocks below them. It may be 60 miles deep. A single tectonic plate may have a continent and part of an ocean on it. The upper mantle is below the crust. The topmost layer of the upper mantle are the tectonic plates. They are solid and brittle. Immediately below the tectonic plates is a layer called the asthenosphere. The tectonic plates slide over the asthenosphere. Although the crust and the tectonic plates are part of different layers, Geologists often use the word lithosphere to refer to the tectonic plates and the crust. Now we're ready to discuss mantle convection, which is a leading theory of what causes the tectonic plates to move. We'll start by doing an experiment to understand convection currents. We fill this glass tube with water, and we'll put some food coloring in the top so we can see the flow direction after we ignite a small fire. Do you think the food coloring will go clockwise, counterclockwise, or both directions? The fluid goes clockwise. The explanation for why hot fluid rises compared with cold fluid is beyond the scope of this video, but we've explained it in the summary notes at the end of the video for those who are interested. One way to remember this is to think of hot air balloons. If all other things are essentially equal, then hot air rises above cold air, which is why balloons rise when the pilot turns on the burner. Likewise, hot fluid will rise above cold fluid. As the hottest fluid in this tube rises from this corner, that creates an opening for cooler fluid along the bottom horizontal part to take its place. And as the hot fluid rises, it also pushes on the warm fluid in the top horizontal segment. Together, these actions create a flow that we call a convection current. All the mantle is made of solid rock. It can deform over the course of millions of years, so it flows. Because it flows, we consider it a fluid that is subjected to convection currents. In this simplified model, the upward moving arrow represents hot mantle rising. A downward arrow represents mantle falling. The horizontal arrows show mantle moving to prevent gaps that otherwise would be made from the upward and downward mantle movements. When we put everything together, we see the upper horizontal arrow moves the tectonic plate. Depending on the region of mantle involved, it may take hundreds of millions of years to make one complete cycle. That may be why tectonic plates only move about an inch per year. Another explanation for plate movement is described as the slab pull theory. To illustrate, we can pretend that the metal is the asthenosphere, and the cloth is like the lithosphere with the vertical part representing a subducted portion. In this theory, we refer to the lithosphere as a slab. As the vertical part descends into the mantle, its weight pulls on the horizontal part of the lithosphere. Much like the weight of the vertical section of cloth will pull on the horizontal portion. In this more complete model, we see multiple arrows representing many convection currents. Slab pull may also be moving some of these tectonic plates. There are also theories which suggest that magma coming up through ocean ridges, like the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, may exert a pushing outward force on adjacent tectonic plates, though as of this writing, that force is thought to play a minor role. Our final topic is to discuss the consistency of the asthenosphere. When we see liquid lava shoot into the air and quickly roll down a volcano's sides before cooling to become rocks, we may incorrectly assume that the tectonic plates are floating on hot liquid. When magma exits a volcano, we call it lava. Magma comes from the asthenosphere, but the asthenosphere has the consistency of rocks. The rock that escapes the asthenosphere quickly changes from a solid rock to become liquid magma when escaping the asthenosphere through a process called decompression melting. This is a somewhat complicated process that is beyond the scope of this video, so we only give explanations in the summary notes. But we mention this given the common misconception that the tectonic plates are floating on liquid. If you would like to learn how these forces have made some famous American mountains, please see our video on that topic. To read a summary and some additional information, please pause the video. If you're interested in practice tests that are similar to state exams, but with detailed, colorful explanations for each answer, then please see our apps in the App Store. Many of these are free and none expire or limit their function. Since we only make educational products for children, none of our apps have third-party advertising, in-app purchasing, or connect to the internet. Please subscribe if you'd like to be notified of future educational videos we make. Thanks for your attention.